We're going to talk for about half an hour, and then there's going to be an opportunity for questions from the floor, and if you're watching the live stream, questions on Twitter, hashtag meet the CEO, hashtag UNSW. So a good opportunity to understand a little bit more about Alison and how she came to be CEO of Australia's largest food and beverage company, and a little bit about the challenges of running such an important company in the country and such being a steward of such iconic brands. As David said in the introduction, you grew up on a farm in Tasmania and you studied chartered accounting, but when was it you first got the seed of ambition that you might want to be a CEO and run a corporation in your own right?
Mark, I think it was definitely when I was at McKinsey. The 10 years that I was lucky enough to spend at McKinsey was very, very formative for me, and it really opened my eyes to a range of different businesses, industries, and also just to really understand how CEOs and boards need to operate and the incredible diversity and challenge of running a company. And it began to appeal to me more and more as I got through my career in McKinsey, and I decided that I really wanted to give that a shot, perhaps a little bit naively, because actually as a consultant, it's not that easy to make a transition to getting a P&L and really getting that management role. So I was fortunate though, I joined ANZ in a more sort of typical move for a consultant, went into strategy and M&A, and at the time I said to John McFarlane, who was the CEO, that I'd love to make a move to get a P&L role, and you know, to his great credit, he followed through on that about 18 months later, and that really gave me that opportunity to start developing my experience as a managing director and then as a CEO.
We'll come back and talk a little bit about that development path in a minute, but is a career in consultancy, we've got many in the room who are starting off in their careers, is a career in consultancy a good foundation, do you think, for a career to then transition and run a business or senior management in a business?
Yeah, definitely for me. It really helped me, first of all, just develop very quickly because the sheer breadth of situations that you got thrown into, having to get up the learning curve really fast, and also just the wonderful people that I worked with who, at McKinsey, as would be the case in many professional services firms, you can't succeed unless you're an outstanding developer of people. That's what the firm rewards. And so the opportunity to be in that environment and work with the people who are outstanding coaches, almost in an apprenticeship style, was wonderful development. And then I think to the breadth of situations also later in your career, it gives you that feeling of, well, you know, this might be a somewhat challenging situation, but I know I've caught a glimpse of it somewhere earlier in my career, or at least I know how to think about it, I know how to break it down, rather than, you know, panic.
If we look at your career, as David said, a stint as a chartered accountant, then McKinsey's, Berri, GrainCorp, the ANZ, and now Coca-Cola Amatil. It's an interesting path, as I was thinking it, from accounting and the general consultancy, from banking, and then into fast-moving consumer goods, then back to a strong agricultural kind of sector, and now in the ultimate fast-moving consumer good business. To what extent do you feel you've developed specialist CEO skills, particularly working now in this sector, or to what extent are those skills, in a sense, quite general and transferable from anything from banking to FMCG?
I think it's much more the latter. So when you look back, it sort of looks logical if you can look back on your career. At the time, looking forward, I knew I wanted to move into a management role after that stint in professional services, which I had. And I always loved food, agriculture, beverage. I loved that sector, so I had that there as a passion. Moving to ANZ was a kind of a logical move. Financial services is large, and it was a great opportunity. But the line role that John McFarlane gave me to run turned out to be regional and rural banking. So it was a perfect fit for me because it really you know, aligned with an area that I was really interested and confident in. And then the move to Berri came about because I guess I felt like I really wanted to run a smaller organisation where you had the end-to-end responsibility. In a bank, while you have a P&L, there's lots of other people who control bits of your P&L, and the idea of having, you know, that end-to-end responsibility, in the case of Berri, that spanned from growers right through to the supermarkets and brands and, and the leading positions we had. And so that was a very logical next move. Again, it only came about because somebody decided, in that case it was Doug Shears, who's a very successful agribusiness entrepreneur, he decided to give me a go.
How did he know you? How did you come on his radar?
Well, it's one of those things. We were introduced through a mutual friend, really, a contact that he knew at ANZ. And he's the kind of person, I know if he'd done a search for the role, I would not have popped up even on the long list. So he's one of those kind of people who, you know, he took a like to me. He thought...
Have you reflected on what he saw in you? I mean, if you're a left-field candidate and if they'd thrown you out to the headhunters, your name wouldn't have been on the list. What was there in you that made him willing to make the punt on you?
Well, it's a really good question, actually. I think that he knew he wanted to shake the culture up of the organisation. He also had four daughters and a wife that he really respected his wife's judgment. And so he liked the idea of having a woman run the business. He liked the idea of a culture change. And my acquaintance must have put in a good word for me, I guess, as well. He respected his judgment, and yeah. I think that helped as well. But it was interesting because, you know, I also talked to some of my advisors and said, well, what do you think? You know, should I do this? And I actually got advice from some of them. They said, oh, no, I don't think so. I don't think it's mainstream enough. You know, you should stay in a blue chip environment. Don't do it. But, you know, I guess we both ended up taking a bit of a risk with that one, but it was a fantastic experience.
What is it? You said you really like working in the food and beverage sector. What is it about that sector that has real appeal for you?
Oh, look, it's real. It's interesting. You know, we can all relate, and everyone's got a point of view. I love the passion that, you know, I can go and talk to anyone about what we do, and they'll have a point of view. I like farmers. You know, I do always have a soft spot for farmers. So, you know, I feel like I have a rapport with a farming community. I'm very passionate about agriculture and our potential as a country. So, you know, I also love the marketing end. I love the brands. I love the sophistication of our big customers. So there's nothing like, you know, an agribusiness going right through to the processing and selling and marketing to have all of that breadth and experience. And there aren't many businesses in Australia now where you do have that sort of end-to-end continuum.
So you talk about that end-to-end continuum. You go to Coca-Cola Amatil, and there are a range of brands there, as we'll discuss, but at its core and its profit and its revenue is Coca-Cola, one of the big iconic brands of the globe, of course. Tell us how running Coca-Cola Amatil is different to those other experiences, and talk a little bit about the relationship you have with Atlanta and the home of Coca-Cola and how that relationship works in practice.
Well, the opportunity to run CCA for me, it's certainly different, but it brought together a lot of other things that I'd done. So the food and beverage experience that I'd had, the experience in being in and around listed companies and being on a board of listed companies, and then the experience at GrainCorp of actually running a listed company, albeit back up the chain a little bit. So it did bring together, I felt like I had all the pieces that would enable me to be successful in that role, and fortunately the chairman and the board agreed with that. So it is though, there are some important differences, and I would say one of them is having a significant shareholder in the Coca-Cola company who's also a very large commercial partner for us, and so being able to work successfully with them is absolutely critical, and they're a massive company. Their market cap's about $200 billion US, so really working out who you need to connect with and making sure that we have the right level of involvement is very important. It's a very multi-dimensional relationship. That's probably the single most different thing, I would say. Apart from that, you know, fundamentally, you're working with people who are very senior, capable, experienced executives. So they're very self-sufficient and independent. They don't need as much sort of coaching and hand-holding as well. In a larger organisation, I think that's, you know, it's a great luxury, but you also need to step back and reassess your own role and think about your own role in terms of how you're guiding them and also how you're actually adding value independent of them.
Mm-hmm. When we think of Coca-Cola, we think of that extraordinary brand and that marketing discipline and focus. What have you learnt from them, and how much of that brand discipline in effect is imposed on you from Atlanta, and what discretion do you have exercising branding and marketing decisions from here?
Yeah, well, I think people have you know, an image of it being very much a cookie cutter thing, and I mean there are certainly aspects of how the brand is treated, for example, that are highly prescriptive. But I've been really pleasantly surprised by the level of flexibility that we have. And I think this is one of the great strengths of the Coca-Cola system, is that it takes the all the power of a global brand and localises it by working in 200 different markets around the country, mostly with local partners like us. So we work very collaboratively. Things like the Share a Coke campaign, which most people would remember, that originated here in Australia. So was developed by us with our partners here, and it's now in 90 markets around the world. Last year we launched our Colour Your Summer campaign, which was the small coloured cans. That was a world first for Coca-Cola as well. So they are very receptive to ideas and things that make sense for local markets. And I think it's, you know, it's a wonderful combination, and it's at its best, it's unbeatable.
The Coke brand is a big part of your business, isn't it? I think I read somewhere, is it two-thirds of profits of Coca-Cola Amatil comes from the Coke family of brands, is that right?
Not quite, but it's a lot, yeah.
Tell us, what are the challenges? You know, it's an iconic brand. What are the challenges that you're dealing with in managing that brand and holding that profitability together now?
Well, obviously, we are going through a lot of changes, and we're fundamentally about the consumer. And if our brands and products aren't relevant for the consumer, then, you know, we start to get into trouble. So probably the number one challenge, I would say, for us is changing consumer tastes. And consumers clearly becoming a lot more concerned about health. We have the backdrop of obesity, which is a very significant mega trend for our society and many other societies around the world. And that is, you know, creating an imperative for change as well.
Do you buy the argument that sugar is a driver of that obesity epidemic?
Well, I buy the argument that there is certainly, you know, a perception around that. If I actually showed you the facts, you know, I could demonstrate quite clearly that in Australia, our sugar consumption has declined over the last 25 years. So we consume about 10% less sugar per capita than we did. We consume more fat. We consume more calories overall. We've put on weight, but the primary contributor is not sugar. It's actually fats, and that's really what's driven it. But I absolutely understand that sugar is definitely seen as an obvious thing to target, and our brand, soft drinks generally as a category, but us as a leader, we're an obvious thing to point to in a way that that we don't seem to point to, you know, chocolate or ice cream or other sources of contribution. But, you know, it is what it is, and I think it's a very, very important topic of conversation for us, and we're making a lot of changes accordingly.
So does that mean that as a share, the red can needs to shrink and the other brand extensions need to grow as a response to that?
Well, absolutely. I mean, Brand Coke is it's a wonderful brand, and you might, if you've noticed our Chris, I'm sure, as a keen observer of our products.
Well, Chris has already admitted to his Coke habit tonight, which I thought was a...
Our most recent advertising it emphasises Coke as it's a master brand. So rather than it being, you know, separate brands, Zero being a separate brand from a Red Coke, for example, you see a master brand that really emphasises the choice. So you'll see the family of four, so a classic Coke, Life, Diet and Zero, and then we're really dialing up the choice that's available, and of course we've been adding to that consistently over time. So yes, we're making that change.
One of the interesting challenges I can see you face is that for a company and a brand that has been so obsessed about its image and its reputation, in this digital world, in this online world, you have less control over the messages that are out there. So how do you deal with those who would say in the 50s and 60s it was tobacco, sugar is the new tobacco, that Coca-Cola Amatil once sold cigarettes, they no longer do, over time sugar will attract the same level of odium and the market will move away. Now you've been strongly critical of those views, but they keep coming at you. How are you going to win this public relations battle in a digital social media world?
Yeah, well, I think we're all learning about social media, and I think we've still definitely got a lot more to learn. So I don't pretend that we're masters of understanding how to use social media well, and I think. I actually see it as a great opportunity, because we do get that feedback straight away, and if we can master it, it's actually a great way to have direct conversations with our consumers and our customers. As far as how we sort of see ourselves, like, first of all, we're incredibly proud of who we are and our products. We fundamentally believe in that in personal responsibility, I guess, as a concept, that we all need to make our own choices, and we don't want to sort of end up creating some sort of nanny state where the government's telling us what we can and can't eat. We believe that our products are completely different to tobacco, because there's no amount of tobacco that's safe to consume. Our products are absolutely fine. Our products are healthy. It's how you consume our products that there can be unhealthy consumption patterns of our products, and that's what we've got to really understand and play a leadership role with the rest of the industry in addressing. So for us, coming back to that sort of philosophy around we want consumers to be able to make choice, then it's our job to give as much choice as we can and to make sure that they can make informed choices for them and their families by providing as much information as we can. So you will have seen us, and really this has been going on, I guess, since 1985, when I think Diet Coke was first introduced. Coke Zero was introduced over 10 years ago. But we're certainly continuing to add to the range, particularly smaller pack sizes, things like Coke Life. We're reformulating a lot of our products, just sort of slowly and steadily taking the sugar out of them. And information, complete information transparency is really important. And I think that's something that we definitely would regard ourselves as being able to do better on.
At the other end of your products is water and Mount Franklin. Now, as someone who grew up on a farm, every now and again, do you ever sit back and think, I can't believe we convince Australians to pay $3 for a bottle of water? Is there sometimes you just... Yeah. What's the margin on water?
it is fascinating, isn't it? But
the directors are happy.
Water is a category clearly that Australians are shifting to, and there are many occasions where we like to drink water out of a bottle for convenience reasons. Particularly, but also, because we love the brand and what it says about us. Mount Franklin, actually, its real acceleration originated over 20 years ago. Those of you who are at the older end of the spectrum, like me, will remember the Sydney Water Giardia scare, yep. I think, back in the early 90s. And that really drove bottled water. But even in the last sort of 2-3 years, we've seen a real acceleration of growth in bottled water.
You showed the advertisement earlier. Mm. One could argue that water is a commoditised product. How do you drive a brand differential, and how do you convince someone that there is a thing that is, you know, premium still water, and that there's a price premium attached to that? What's the marketing challenge there?
Yeah, well, look, Mount Franklin is a trusted brand, and so you want to know that what you're drinking is, you know, is made to the highest quality standards. So that's certainly part of it. Mount Franklin also has many other sparkling. So there's sparkling, there's flavours. You go, and we're very excited about a lot of the innovation. Believe it or not, water is one of the most innovative categories. There are vitamin waters, there are smart waters, and consumers, I think, you know, we drink obviously for a functional benefit. We're thirsty, so we want to drink. But we drink for a lot of other reasons as well, and there's just a real love for our brand. And if you're in the business of building brands, it's really, really important to understand those emotional connections that people have and invest in them as well, because, you know, that is part of what people are paying for when they buy a Mount Franklin.
Okay. Just a few other quick questions from me. Shortly, we're going to go to the audience and go to the Twitter feed, hashtag meet the CEO. I'm just throwing softballs here, Alison. This is where the drama is going to happen when the questions emerge from the audience.
Right.
Now, interestingly, you've been on the board of Woolworths, and now you're a major supplier to mm-hmm. Woolworths.
Yep.
Talk a bit about that dynamic, and now you're no longer a Woolies director. How healthy is it that we've got two grocers, in effect, who have an 80% plus market share, and what kind of power and pressure do they put on even such a strong brand as Coca-Cola Amatil?
Right. That's the softball question.
That's a softball.
Right.
These, believe me, I've been here before. It's all going to get dramatic shortly.
Right. Okay, you're warming me up. Well, I think, yes, it was actually a great experience to serve on the board of Woolworths and really get the customer perspective. And I think in any business, when you're working in a business, it's really helpful if you understand the mindset of your customers and you're thinking about your customers, and it's a natural part of what you do. So I think I learnt a lot from that experience. I think also at Woolworths, I was able to be the voice of the supplier because I had that experience as well. And that was really what I tried to do, and to really encourage Woolies to think longer term about the supply chain. So I'm actually really encouraged to see today a retail environment where I do think we've had quite a demonstrable shift in the last couple of years, and our larger retailers are working more constructively with suppliers, because we do need to make sure that we have got good good capability, good manufacturing and food processing capability, good innovation. Here in Australia, you can't just rely on importing it. As we've seen, you know, the dollar now is much, much lower. So our food will start to get very expensive. And there are just a lot of things that consumers don't want to buy from overseas. So SPC, which is one of our businesses, is benefiting very much from that desire. So there are a lot of reasons why we need good onshore capability. And I think we went through a bit of a rough trot as suppliers. I think our customers have a more balanced view on that, which is a good thing.
Is part of the pressure around price, you know, Woolworths drove a big thing on everyday low prices. I read one report that Coca-Cola is as expensive in Australia as anywhere in the Western world. Is there pressure from Coles and Woolies for you to be lowering your prices? And how much is the battle around you wanting to maintain your pricing power and your pricing premium over your competitor?
Well, I think price is certainly an aspect, and the retailers are very focused on giving their consumers better value. That's a big driver at the moment. But, you know, we do need actually price growth in our industry. It's not just about the suppliers, but it's also for the retailers. If they want to grow their profitability, if you continue to just sort of sell private label product at lower and lower per unit prices and lower margins, that's not a great recipe. You really need to develop categories as a whole. So there's a real role for premium products such as ours, for brand owners such as us who invest in brands and innovation. And yes, we do have higher prices, but that's what enables us to put back into the brands and to come to the market with new products, such as the launch of Coke Life, for example, last April. And that really helps the retailers too. So there is a real symbiotic relationship between us. Sometimes it's not easy to work together constructively, but we're putting a big effort into that. And I think we're making progress with our major customers because it makes sense for everyone to drive the value of the category overall.
We're about to have questions. So if you have questions, you might want to look out for the microphones that are going to be around. Yesterday, Diane Smith-Gander, the chair of Transfield and the president of Chief Executive Women, started talking about, you know, 50-50 targets on boards. And there is a proposal that's been developed by crossbench senators around this. And one of her lines was that capable men would have to make way for capable women for that kind of target to be reached. Can you talk a little bit about your observations around boards and how we should go about, as a society and as a business community, increasing the representation of women on boards, and what about on management teams as well?
Mm-hmm. Well, I do definitely think we need diversity on boards, and in every part of our organisations, diversity of all kinds is really important. And I think I'm a big supporter of the process that has been driven by the ASX with the measurable objectives around gender diversity that listed companies are required to set and then hold themselves to account and report on. I believe in, you know, from having worked across a number of different companies and understanding board succession and how that works, I think it's by far better to have each company set targets that make sense for itself, its context, its succession planning, and, you know, to strive to achieve those targets. I still feel that it would be a failure on the corporate sector if we end up with government-imposed quotas, because I do think that is a very blunt instrument, and there'll be some organisations who probably should be striving for a greater than that mandatorily imposed target, and there'll be others who may need a little bit more time.
Do you think that's
the right approach. For
why any industry or any company shouldn't aspire down the track to a 50-50 target?
No, I don't. And I think certainly a 30% target, which is really the stake in the ground at the moment, that should be very doable for, you know, pretty much every company. Really, you don't have to try too hard to do that. Even, you know, in agriculture, which I've worked in a lot, which tends to be more traditional, I've seen wonderful examples, including GrainCorp, where they've made some really good progress on getting great women on the boards. You need to step back and sometimes rethink how you're defining the criteria, because sometimes, and actually quite often, that's the limiting factor. We define what we're looking for too narrowly and therefore limit the pool of talent that we're looking into.
What about executive teams? I looked at your group leadership team at Coca-Cola Amatil, and apart from you, as I read it anyway, of the eight on the executive, apart from you, only one of those is a woman. Your head of HR, and all your big P&L divisions are run by men. As vacancies emerge, how important is it for you to put more women on that executive team and in P&L roles?
It's important. I think we should have more, and particularly the P&L roles, because I've been fortunate to have been given the opportunities that I have, and I know that if you are in one of those P&L roles, you are able to have an influence on the culture of an organisation in a way that it's harder to have from a functional role. You're playing a valuable role and you are a catalyst for change, whatever role you're in, but I think that is going to be a real step forward. So yes, it is a priority.
Okay. Right, we're going to go to questions from the floor now. And also, if there are messages that are coming in from social media, we'll take those as well. Now, the lights up here are blinding, so we need you to wave if you have a question. Now, don't be intimidated by saying that your questions needed to be intimidating. They don't have to be intimidating. So, now a microphone
in fact,
down the front. Oh, we've got one up the back there. We'll take that one first. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Lovely.
Just, yeah.
There's a gap in the market.
Sorry, can you just start that again? The mic just didn't like,
There's a gap in the market, and the problem has been for about 26 years. With the people who are running around, they get dehydrated. And unfortunately, my brother, a University Blue, University of New South Wales in athletics, suffered a catastrophic accident and had his leg amputated. From that time in 1988, I have a science background, he's a science background, we've looked at the different drinks that are on the market. And unfortunately, there isn't anything that really has electrolyte and hydration balance that an athlete or a person who's doing extreme like exercising needs. In your R&D, or if I decided to get excited and wanted to do further research or wanted to follow this, would your company be able to help me?
And do you do that R&D here? Does R&D happen here, or is it really happening offshore?
No, certainly there's certainly R&D happening here. We have a number of very local products, and we're always interested in gaps in the market, definitely. So I do actually believe there are a couple of niche products, but they may not be exactly what you have in mind. So definitely feel free to drop me an email, and we'll connect you with the right people and make sure that you're aware of what is there, and then if there's something we can talk about, we'd be delighted to.
Thanks for the question. Yes, next down here.
Alison, thanks very much for your insights so far. I was particularly interested if you're able to share a little bit more about the concepts around the global collaboration that exists in your business, obviously a very large American-based parent, and you talked about a number of examples of adaptation locally working very well on that sharing of information back to the broader global business. I'm just wondering maybe a few other little things that are examples of what works well in that type of environment with your business and engagement with the parent.
Yeah, well, I really think about three things, I suppose, in thinking about how their relationship's working. And the first one is alignment. The second one is more our processes. And then the third one is the relationships, the personal relationships. So we focus on all three of those things. So alignment is particularly about making sure that we're trying to achieve the same things. So we have the same vision and definition of success. And we have our financial incentives are aligned as well, because that's actually really important. If you've got somebody who's rewarded for one thing and somebody who's pulling in the opposite direction, that's a problem. So alignment is really important to pay attention to. Processes, so making sure that there's just good working relationships between us, good routines, you know, plans, we get together, we identify issues before things go off the rails, that kind of thing is really important just to the rhythm of how we work together. And then relationships. It's really important to think about all the different people that we need to connect with, who needs to connect where, because I'm very conscious with our business MDs, I don't want to be tripping over and, you know, sending a different message than they might be sending. So we're quite clear on, you know, who's whose counterpart, and we communicate pretty well about, you know, how the relationship's sort of working at that level, who we're talking about with what the themes are, and try to handle it that way. So I think it's a combination of all of those things. I think it's really important that the relationship is not just about individual relationships, so the alignment and the processes, because, you know, I'm only here for a period of time, so are my colleagues, there's change all the time, and so you really need to build in the alignment and the processes to make sure that the relationship endures and prospers beyond the individuals who are directly involved.
Alison, one of the questions that's come through from social media is about Coca-Cola Life. I imagine that some who've studied the business school have explored the challenges that Coke faced when they created New Coke all those decades ago. Mm. New brands can be fraught. The question is, has Coca-Cola Life failed? What's your assessment of how it's gone since it's been on the market?
No, look, we're very happy with how Coca-Cola Life is going. So we...
How's it different for those of us who don't have the Dean's consumption habits? If we did the blind taste test here with Diet Coke and Coke Zero and Coca-Cola Life, how are they different?
Well, I would defy you to distinguish between a regular Coke and a Coke Life. They really do taste the same.
Oh, we should have done that. If we'd known she was going to say that, we'd have had the blind taste test for Chris.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun, actually. We, you know, marketing directors and technical directors, people who absolutely should understand these things, have been unable to differentiate. So it really does taste like a regular Coke. It's 35% less calories than a regular Coke, and that's achieved by using stevia, which is a natural sweetener. It's derived from the chrysanthemum plant, and it still has some sugar, but stevia allows us to reduce the calories. Now, why I'm excited about Coke Life, and you know why it's a really important addition to the family, is because natural sweeteners are very, very important for the future of our category. There are consumers who are concerned about artificial sweeteners, so aspartame, which Chris is, it's absolutely, absolutely perfectly safe. In fact, I think you could considerably increase your consumption levels and still be... Yeah, so there are many, many hundreds of studies, and so it is absolutely, there's no issues with it, but there are, you know, people... More consumers who say, well, I don't care, I just don't want to drink an artificial sweetener, I want a naturally sweetened product. So natural sweeteners is the number one research priority for the Coca-Cola company, and they are on a mission to get the natural sweetened calories down and down and down. So, you know, I hope that it won't be too long before we can have a zero calorie natural sweetened version of Coke Life. So, you know, with new products, you know, introducing a new member to the Coke family, this is something that we're doing in other markets around the world. We are absolutely, you know, playing the long game here, and we're tracking very well against the other markets that we benchmark ourselves against. So
okay,
it's all good.
Question over here. Yeah.
Yep. So Alison, you spoke really highly in the beginning that your time at McKinsey really helped shape your career. So I was just interested to know, what were the three biggest lessons you learned as a consultant that really helped you on your journey to be CEO? And I guess, what are the things that you still apply today that you've learned during that experience?
Well, I would say probably the most important lesson that I learned from McKinsey was the importance of working with good people. People you respect and can learn from, and creating a relationship where it's a productive one, where you can learn from them, because you can sort of be around good people, not necessarily learn from them if they're not great coaches. Or so the importance of working with great people was definitely, and you know, for me, in taking any role subsequently, I've always, and in any advice, I always really ask people to think about who you're going to be working with, who you're surrounded by, who's on your board, are they people that you respect and can learn from? And I think that was certainly, you know, a really big lesson. Second big lesson for me from McKinsey was the importance of values and really understanding values. And I think, you know, I'm sure it's the same in many professional services firms, but certainly at McKinsey, the values, you know, were really, really strong. So, for example, one of our values was the obligation to dissent, which meant that, you know, if you joined yesterday and you were sitting next to a director who'd been around for 20 years, and you were in a discussion and you didn't agree or you had a point of view, you know, you had an obligation to speak up, not to just be quiet and say nothing. And really the environment was very much that you were encouraged to have that point of view and try and, you know, remove the hierarchy, which I guess for me is probably the third lesson, because I really think that if you can create an environment, corporates tend to be intrinsically much more
hierarchical and big corporates and corporates that have been around for a long time. And hierarchy, you know, can stifle a lot of creativity, initiative, and ideas. So really trying to create that.
What strategies do you have in place in what must be a fairly hierarchical business to ensure that the right kind of ideas are bubbling through and bubbling through to you as CEO?
Well, I think, I mean, it's for me about being just being open and accessible and listening a lot and really trying to create an environment where people feel that they can trust me and create an environment where they, you know, all of our leaders are open and people that you would trust. So I think trust is an essential ingredient. If you trust someone and you feel that they're open with you and they're consistent in what they, you know, they do what they say and they say what they do, then I think that does create an environment where people feel like they can speak up and you're interested, or they can take a risk. And so, you know, just as a small thing, I have a blog that I do pretty regularly, and I just talk about, you know, what's going on around the place. And I always, you know, include something personal, what I did on the weekend. I love getting out and about around the organisation and just sort of meeting people who do the everyday heroes. Just yesterday, we took our board actually to our national sales centre, which is really like a call centre. And I sat down with one of our consultants and put on the headphones, had a chat to him, and, you know, it turns out that he used to, I asked him, what did you do before you joined us? And he used to run poker tournaments in pubs around Sydney. And then he decided that he wanted to do an applied finance degree at Macquarie University. Sorry, Macquarie, I should have,
It was a great anecdotal.
I told him he made that mistake wrong. And now he's working with us, and he asked me, you know, well, what business books would you recommend that I read? And I find every person I talk to has got some really interesting, surprising story, and I just love to try and, you know, hear that. And I think, I hope that that does create an environment where we get that flow. It's not sort of from the top coming down, but we get a real dialogue and conversation going.
Another question through on Twitter talks about Woolworths, and we talked about Woolworths earlier. I mean, 5-6 years ago, it was clearly in an advantageous position compared to Coles, and Coles has come back quite strongly, and now all the pressure is around Woolworths. They're looking for a new CEO, changes at the board. What's your assessment of the current state of Woolworths and future prospects?
Well, I think, you know, Woolies is a wonderful company, and they're still, you know, on every metric, they're a very strong company. So if you, you know, compare them with the other retailers on profit per square metre or, you know, sales productivity, they're a very strong company. Yes, it's very disappointing, I think, to see the difficult period that they're going through. But if you look, you know, go back to the 90s, you know, Woolworths was completely, you know, virtually broke, and Coles was in the ascendancy. We then went through a period where Woolies really got its act together and Coles lost its way. So, you know, these things seem to tend to happen. They're both, you know, fundamentally really strong businesses.
Yeah. One of the analysts talk about the Masters development and their movement into hardware and the like. How do you weigh up the challenge and the opportunity of growth by acquisitions and being bold and courageous in those areas compared to driving your core business hard and well?
It's a really good question. It's a hard question, and in part it depends what investors are looking for at a point in time as well. So our investors at the moment are very yield focused and heavily, and you know, they're very anxious about going and spending capital on things that may or may not work. But at another period in the cycle, you'd be heavily criticised for not having any growth options, and you know, where's the growth going to come from? So it's very hard. I think for a Woolworths, it's very hard to grow, you know, too much organically in this market. So if you want to grow, you have to look at acquisitions and you have to look at intelligent investment. I think the hardware sector is actually a pretty logical place for them to go. But yeah, obviously the execution hasn't been quite as straightforward.
Okay, yes, question here.
You've obviously been very, very successful, but it seems with many successful people, they've made mistakes or, you know, learned things along the way. Is there anything about, you know, your journey as a CEO, you know, the difference between you as a CEO as you started out versus a CEO now? Are there any mistakes or learnings you've learned that you could share with people?
Oh, definitely, lots. I've definitely learnt a lot. I think probably one of the hardest things, which I knew, I was aware as a former consultant, you know, could be an issue, but definitely was something I had to really be conscious of, was your desire to overanalyze, get into the detail, really want to understand everything about every decision, and to be quite considered before you made a decision. So one of the really important things I've had to learn is to quickly figure out, is this a decision that matters that much? Is it a decision that I can add value to, or should I just, basically trust the people who've put this forward as a recommendation, figure out a couple of questions to ask them to validate that judgment and that trust, and then really back their decision. And I was very lucky. I worked actually with Elizabeth Proust when I was at McKinsey, who maybe some of you would know, and she'd had worked in government, and she was a master of, sort of just getting things done and keeping things moving, making decisions, delegating really well, and not letting issues bog her down. So the pace and keeping things moving through being decisive and figuring out where to dive in and where not to bother, that's been probably the biggest thing. And I hope I've got better at that, but I'm sure I can still improve.
Time for one last question from the floor. Yeah, just here.
So I just had a question around what you saw as the kind of future for Coca-Cola. I mean, you've talked about potentially the launch of Coke Life and, stevia products, but Australia is, in some respects, the mature market. So, and you mentioned that some investors are focusing on yield, or in particular for Woolworths, but for Coke. So how are you focusing on, what are those long-term growth options that you're thinking about for Coke? Is it another product launch? Is it more market penetration? What are you seeing as being the long-term growth option for Coke?
Yeah, well, look, we're very fortunate to have positions across a whole range of beverage categories. So the sparkling category or soft drinks, that's about 50% of the non-alcoholic territory. So there's sports, there's energy, there's dairy, there's water, there's juice. And we've got, to varying degrees, positions already. But while we absolutely will continue to invest and develop brand Coke, because we play such an important role in that category and we can make such a difference, we'll continue to build our position across those other categories. And then also into alcohol. So we have a partnership with Beam Suntory, which gives us some great brands in spirits. We also have our own brewery now. We have a partnership with a number of international brands. We have SPC, which has been through a bit of a near-death experience, but is at last in a much better position now, and I think there's some exciting opportunities there. So it is really important to have those areas of growth. I think we have a really great opportunity. The whole beverage space is a really exciting one. There's lots of consumers are always looking for something different, new, innovative. And we've got wonderful strengths in who we are to be able to be one of the prime movers. And there's a lot of areas that we can grow into, I'm really confident.
Ladies and gentlemen, a true believer. Thanks so much, Alison, for sharing your story and sharing the story of Coke and manufacturing in the modern Australian economy. The hour has disappeared on us so quickly. Now, Vicky McFadden from the UNSW Business School Advisory Council will come and propose a vote of thanks to Alison. Vicky.
How privileged are we to be here tonight to listen to Alison and interviewed so well by Mark. Thank you, both of you. But Alison, you've showed us some great insight into who you are and why you're such a great leader of Coca-Cola Amatil. You shared your experience of the importance of the development of people, particularly when you're at a consulting firm, and that professional services firms do that rather well. But what I took away from that was that as a leader, you are concerned and ensure that the people who work with you are developed. And what a wonderful quality that is for a leader. Essential, one would think. It also struck me that you followed your passion. How wonderful to be able to have a successful career following your passion. I hope that's something that we can all do. And thirdly, your approach is one of collaboration and one based on trust and values, essential for leadership. And Mark, thank you very much for your interviewing. We greatly value your perspective as both an interviewer and a CEO. Thank you both very much. And a reminder, too, about our next Meet the CEO. It's on November the 19th with Ian Narev from the Commonwealth Bank, and invitations are going out very soon. So thank you all for coming tonight and participating, perhaps online. Thank you very much and good night.